In this segment, we'll take a physical example of what is the application of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. There are many physical applications of eigenvalues and eigenvectors, but we just concentrate on a simple one which you can follow based on your knowledge of physics. So let's suppose somebody says that, hey, I'm going to give you a spring here, I'm going to put a mass next to it, and I'm going to put another spring here, and I'm going to put a mass right here. And what I want to do is, let's suppose the spring stiffness is K here, the spring stiffness is K here. We're assuming the two springs have the same stiffness. Let's suppose we want to say this is mass M1 and this is mass M2. That's the mass of this first mass and mass of the second mass. And what we want to do is we want to be able to measure what X1 and X2 are. So we're trying to figure out, hey, how does this mass M1 and M2 move when you are either forcing it to move by, maybe let's suppose you might pull it or you might keep on adding some forcing function to it. But let's suppose, let's take a simple case where you simply pull this mass M2, M1 also gets pulled with it, and then you just, let's suppose you leave it alone. What's going to happen is that the M1 mass is going to oscillate, M2 is also going to oscillate, or maybe not oscillate depending on the values of K. In this case, they are going to oscillate because there's no damping. We're not assuming any damping. So we want to be able to figure out, hey, how does X1 and X2 vary as a function of time? And then we'll see that, hey, how does this relate to our application of eigenvalues and eigenvectors? So if you look at the free body diagram of the mass M1, so you have M1 mass right here. And let's suppose if I assume X1 to be greater than 0, and then I assume X2 to be greater than X1. So I'm not saying that this is what's really happening when this system is moving, but let's suppose we are saying that at a particular time, X1 is greater than 0 and X2 is greater than X1. So if that's the case, now what's going to happen is that if X1 is greater than 0, this spring is going to stretch. So if you look at the K1 spring, it is going to stretch. So if it is stretching, that means that it has to have a tensile force in it. So if that's the tensile force in the spring K1, that means that the reaction of that force will be like this in on the mass itself. So that will be KX1. So because this is going to stretch by a distance of x1, and the amount of force which will be stored in the spring, or the force which will be experienced by the spring, will be kx1. So since this direction is like this, that means that the equal and opposite force has to act on the mass, will be kx1. When we're assuming x2 is greater than x1, then if we take the spring 2, again, if x2 is greater than x1, that means that this spring has stretched, because it's moving, x2 is more than x1, so this is stretched out, because x1 is moving a little less, is moving less than what the x2 is moving. So it'll be stretched out like this, so the amount of force that should be existing in the spring will be k times x2 minus x1. So if that is the case, then we know that, hey, that's on this side right here. So that means that we will have k times x2 minus x1 going this way. So it's just the opposite force should be existing. So your force is k times x2 minus x1 going this way on the spring on this side. So the reaction from the mass will be that one. Now these are the only forces which are acting on mass M1. And what we're going to do is we are going to sum the forces on mass M1. So I'm going to get kx1 plus kx2 minus x1. And what this is going to be equal to, so this will be minus kx1, because let's suppose we say negative is to the left side and positive is the right side. So we get minus kx1 from here, plus kx2 minus x1 from here, and that will be equal to the inertial force in the mass, and that will be m1 times d2 x1 by dt square. So that's what I'm going to get from there. So if I'm going to simplify this, I don't need to simplify it, it will be like that. So that's what our first equation is going to be for mass m1. Let's look at m2. On m2, you can very well see that the only force which will be existing will be this way, will be kx2 minus x1, because that I can note from here that, hey, since the force in M1 is going to be to the right, then the equal and opposite force has to act on M2 in this, in the opposite direction. Or I can look at it this way, that hey, the force is going this way, the force is going this way in the spring, so it has to be opposite of that in experienced by the mass by Newton's third law of motion. So I got M2 right there. So what I get is minus K X2 minus X1 is equal to, that's the force going in the negative direction there, or in the negative X2 direction. So the total inertial force will be M2 D2 X2 by DT square. So this is one differential equation and this is second differential equation. So what you're getting is that this system is governed by two second order differential equations which are simultaneous in nature, because you are finding out the two dependent variables x1 and x2 are in both of these equations right there. So let's see if we put some numbers in there what happens. So let's choose m1 equal to 10. So I'm not using any units or anything like that, so I'm keeping it unitless. So m2 is equal to 20, and let's suppose k is 15. So what does that do to our equation? So the first equation which I write here will turn out to be that I get 10 d2 x1 by dt square is equal to minus 15 x1 plus 15 x2 minus x1. And if I take all of these to the left hand side, what do I get from there? So I have 15 x2 minus 15 x1. So I get 10 d2 x1 by dt square plus 15 2 x1 minus x2 equal to 0. So if I take this to the left hand side, this is what I'll be able to get. That's equation 1 rewritten as in terms of the numbers and everything taken to the left hand side. Similarly, the second equation which I have right here, if I do the same kind of substitution, I'll get 20. I'll get 20 d2x by dt square minus 15 x1 minus x2 equal to 0. And that will be my second equation. That's simply by substituting m2 equal to 20 here, k equal to 15 here, I'm taking that to the left hand side. That's what I'm going to get as my two equations. Now, so these are the two equations which are going to govern my system coupled with some initial conditions. But let's go and see that how this is related to eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So from vibration theory, if you have taken the vibrations class, you will be quite familiar with this. But if you have not, I'm just giving it to you that your displacements will be of this form, AI sine omega t minus phi, let's suppose. So each of the displacements x1 and x2, so I is equal to 1, I is equal to 1 and 2, will be of the sinusoidal form, where a sub I is the amplitude of mass I, and omega is the frequency of vibration, the angular frequency of vibration, and then let's suppose phi is given as the phase shift. So if we assume that is the case, then let's go and see that when we substitute it back into our differential equations, what happens. We have d2 xi by dt square in both the differential equations. So if I take the second derivative of this, I will get minus ai omega square sine omega t minus phi. That's what I'm going to get from the second derivative of this x of I. And now I'm going to substitute this into my differential equation. So if I look at the first differential equation, I'm going to get minus 10 a1 omega square sine omega t minus phi minus 15 times minus 2a1 sine omega t minus phi plus a2 sine omega t minus phi equal to 0. That's what I'm going to get from the first differential equation. And the second differential equation, if I make these substitutions of x of I and d d2xi by dt squared, in this case being x2, I will get minus 20 a2 omega squared sine omega 2 minus phi minus 15 a1 sine omega t minus phi plus a2 sine omega t minus phi, and that will be equal to 0. And now you're finding out this sine omega t minus phi is a common term, so I'm going to take that out, and because if sine omega t minus phi is 0 everywhere, which is not going to be the case, then I'll have a trivial solution for my displacement, which is not true. So I can very well get rid of this sine omega t minus phi here, sine omega t minus phi here, sine omega t minus phi here, same thing here, same thing here, and same thing here. What does that give me? That basically gives me the following thing. It gives me minus 10 a1 omega squared minus 15 minus 2 a1 plus a2 equal to 0 minus 20 a2 omega squared minus 15 a1 minus a2 equal to 0. So this is first equation, this is second equation. This is what I get by taking out the sine omega t minus phi term out. Okay, if I collect now the a1 term, so it gives me minus 10 omega squared plus 30 a1 minus 15 a2 equal to 0. That's the first equation. And the second equation would be minus 15 a1 plus minus 20 omega squared plus 15 a2 is equal to 0. So we are basically getting two equations, two unknowns, if we consider a1 and a2 to be the two unknowns. And we don't know what omega is, but let's suppose we consider those to be two unknowns. Then in this case now, what we want to find out is that if I simplify this a little bit further, like suppose divided by 15 throughout, I might be able to, so I can divide by 15 throughout, I'll get minus omega square plus 3 a1 minus 1.5 a2 equal to 0. And this one here also, I'm going to, let's suppose, divide by 15, I get minus 0.75 a1 plus minus omega square plus 0.75 a2 equal to 0. And the reason why I did this was, here I divided by 10 and I got this, here I divided by 20. The only reason why I'm doing this is because I want to make the coefficient of omega square in both cases, of course with a1, to only have 1 there. So 1 times a1 here, minus 1 times a1 here and minus 1 times a2 here. So if I now write it like in the matrix form, let's see what happens if I write it in the matrix form. I get a1 here and I get a2 here, and of course I'll get 0 and 0 here because that's the right hand side. So I can look at the coefficient of a1, it is minus omega squared plus 3, it's minus 1.5 here, minus 0.75 here, and minus omega squared plus 0.75 here. I can break it down further. I can write like this. I can say, hey, let me only put known quantities here in this matrix, and then I'll have something else here and unknown quantities associated with this. So what I mean by saying that, hey, if I put a1 and a2 here and I don't want to put omega square term here and omega square term in this matrix here, I'll put 3 and minus 1.5 here, minus 0.75 here, and 0.75 here, and I'll put omega squared here. So once that is done, I can now see that, hey, let's suppose if I assume omega squared is equal to lambda, let's suppose I want to call this, not the minus, but the omega squared, let's suppose to be lambda, what do I get from there? And I call this, let's suppose, to be A. Let's suppose I call this to be the A matrix. I call this to be the X matrix. And that's lambda is omega squared. I call this the X matrix. So what do I get? I get A times X minus lambda times x is equal to 0 vector, and I get a times x is equal to lambda times x. So what's going to happen is that this is the eigenvalue problem, because lambda, how is the eigenvalue defined? Eigenvalue is defined as that, hey, if there is a non-zero vector x for which a times the non-zero vector x is equal to some scalar times the non-zero vector x, then lambda is considered to be the eigenvalue of the problem. So if I'm able to find lambda, I'll be able to find omega square, which will give me the frequency, the angle of frequency within which the system is running. So that's where the eigenvalues show us that, hey, how we can use for the physics of the problem. This x is called, so this one is called the eigenvalue, of course. And whatever is the corresponding vector x is called the eigenvector. And you can very well see that the eigenvector is a measure of a1 and a2, which is simply a measure of the amplitudes which the spring mass system is having. So that's how the physics of the problem and the eigenvalue, eigenvector concept are involved. And that's the end of this segment.